Blessed be the name of the Lord our God. Is he great, saints? Is he great? He's great and he's greatly to be praised. Pastor Kimmy Montgomery, senior pastor of Master's Touch Christian Outreach Center, here with you once again on this thankful Thursday Bible study with you. And I'm so glad to be back with you. Just as promised, here we are. Tonight we're going to attempt to complete our teaching on the power of words. This should be our final teaching on that. This is part four, and we should complete that teaching tonight. So without going into a whole lot of to do tonight, let's go ahead and get right into the word so we can complete this series tonight. I hope you've enjoyed the three previous sessions, and we'll do our best to complete this thing tonight. So why don't you just grab your Bibles, get your pens, your paper out, and let's get ready to do a little Bible study as we complete the Power of Words, Part 4. Let's take a look in our Bibles at Mark chapter 11, verse 24 through 26. This is the scripture we ended on last week. And I'm going to just recap this scripture, and then we'll go ahead and get into the finality of the session. Praise God. So if you'll turn to Mark chapter 11, verse 24 through 26, reading from the King James Version, it says, "Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. And when you stand praying, forgive. If you have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive you of your trespasses." So that's got a lot to say about where our attitude lies concerning forgiving others. You know, all through life, people do this and people do that to us. People say things to us. And, you know, a couple of sessions before, I talked about how the biggest lie we was ever told, that when they said sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt us. That was one of the biggest lies that was ever perpetrated, because words do hurt and words sting, and words cause things to rise up on the inside of you. And one of those things is unforgiveness. When someone says something to you and it offends you or takes you in a totally different direction, you have a tendency to hold unforgiveness. But I wanted to read that scripture because forgiveness is the key to us obtaining from God, because if we don't forgive, then God doesn't forgive us. And so that means everything that we've done and everything that we're doing is all in vain, because we'll not be forgiven of our sins. And therefore, that means there'll be no heaven for us. Amen. And glory to God, we want to go to heaven. Amen. So I thought I'd read that scripture just to get us on the right mindset about forgiving, letting things go, casting our cares on God, because God cares for us. Amen. Now, during the sessions, just a little brief recap here. During the sessions, we talked about three specific things: standing when you pray, believing when you pray, and receiving when you pray. If, as we are praying, we don't know the language of God. There's a language that God speaks. That language is his word. So if, as we are praying, we don't know the language of God or are not using God's language, then we accomplish nothing and we get zero results, because we're not speaking the language of God. Let's take a look at James chapter 4, verse 3. James chapter 4, verse 3. Reading from the King James, it says, "You ask and receive not." And why is this, according to the scripture? "Because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lust." Now, that word amiss, it means in a wrong way. We ask in a wrong way, or it means to astray wrongly, faultfully, improperly. So sometimes when we're praying, we're not praying God's language. Well, all the time, matter of fact, if we're not praying God's language, then our prayers are being prayed amiss. We're missing the mark. They are being prayed in the wrong way. They're going astray. This is why they never reach God's ears, because they're going astray. They're wrongfully and faultfully, and they're improperly prayed. So according to James 4:3, a lot of times we can ask and we wonder, why haven't we received from God? It's because we may be asking amiss, asking for something that we can consume upon our own lusts. You know, the old saying, my for no more, always asking God for something pertaining to us. But God says, whatsoever good thing you do for another, that he'll do the same for you. So it's not just about ourselves when we're speaking words, but it's about the impact those words are going to have once they come out of our mouths, whether it's spoken about our individual situation or somebody else's. Praise God. So once we get our words or our confessions right, God is just waiting to shower us down with his blessings. Praise the Lord. There are always conditions, though, to achieving these blessings. The word shall, we hear shall a lot in the Bible. You know that word means to be indebted? Shall means to be indebted. And God shall, that means God's indebted. What's he indebted to? He's not indebted to us. He's indebted to his word. God is faithful and just to perform his word. So the words that God has spoken out, when in the beginning God said, let there be, let there be, let there be, God began to speak these things out of his mouth, life. And then it concluded by saying, and everything that God made was good. So what God spoke out of his mouth was good things, and we have to follow in that same avenue as God. But that word shall means to be indebted. Let's go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10, and we're going to read this from the Amplified Version. Oh, I really love this. From the Amplified Version. Praise God. It says, God is faithful. Oh, yes, he is. God is faithful. He is reliable. He's trustworthy and ever true to his promise. Whew. He can be depended on. And I know I try to depend on some people. You may have too, and they let us down. But God can be depended on. And through him, you were called into fellowship with his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. But the scripture goes on to say in verse 10, but I urge you, believers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in full agreement in what you say, and that there be no divisions or factions among you, but that you be perfectly united in your way of thinking and in your judgment about matters of the faith. Glory to God. You see, it's so vitally important that the body of Christ is unified, that the body of Christ is speaking God's language, because it's all about the faith. And as we begin to say this and we begin to say that, and one brother saying this and one brother saying that, it's division. And the Bible says two cannot walk together except they be agreed. So, saints, this is why it's so important that we learn to speak the language of God, the proper language. And when we're speaking the language of God, then we won't worry about hitting and missing. We'll be right on the mark because we're speaking God's language. And we understand God's language is his word, and his word does not return to him void, but it accomplishes everything he sends or purposes it to do. Praise God. The critical mistakes we make in life that cause us not to get results a lot of times comes from us not really grasping what is being said from our own mouths, not grasping the very thing that's being said from our own mouths. Examples of some critical mistakes is this. We speak concerning a thing, but we don't fully know what the word says about that thing. Seems like everybody wants to be an authority on something. Everybody's got an opinion, but what does the word have to say about that situation? So one of those critical mistakes a lot of times we'll make is we'll speak concerning a thing and we not fully know what the word says concerning that thing. Our speech must align with God's word and his will. James 1:19 says it like this. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. Second thing is a critical mistake is we look at speaking to mountains like some magic charm.
Oh, glory to God. We look at it like we got this magic charm that we can use when we get in trouble and want something, and then go back to our same old ways after God comes and delivers us. Proverbs chapter 26, verse 11 says this, says it better. It says, as a dog returns to his vomit, so a fool repeats his folly. Lord knows I don't want to be labeled no fool. And the Bible says, if I go back to the same thing over and over again, it's just like a dog returning to his vomit. You didn't got rid of the thing that upset your stomach. You got rid of the thing that was bothering you. And now you're going to go back and consume it again. That's what the Bible's talking about. Until we grasp, saints, until we grasp hold of what God has to say and how we are to say it. Because I want to say that, because sometimes we say things and we take them out of context, and it's not what God was saying. Amen. So I want to put that in there. But until we grasp a hold of what God has to say and how we are to say it, we're going to remain in an infant or baby state for far too long and not experience God's fullness. See, we want to experience the fullness of God. And God has given us every avenue to do that through his word. And if we learn that language of how to speak his word, man, I love what that centurion said about his servant. He said, Jesus, you don't even have to come to my house because I know what your word means. You speak the word only and my servant shall be healed. Now that's getting a hold of what God's word is all about. And that's where I want to be. And that's where I want you guys to be. I hope that's where you want to be, is that we speak the word only concerning circumstances. We speak the word only concerning those situations. And we don't get caught up into being opinionated about something. Or as I said in one of the previous sessions, trying to diagnose a thing when God's word is specific and clear on what he says concerning that thing. So we speak the word only concerning this thing. And until we can grab a hold of what God has to say and how we are to say it, we'll remain in that infantile or baby stage for way too long, missing out on so much that God has for us, and not everyone experiences God's fullness. You know, babies go around for a long time, do do da da ma ma ba ba, but sooner or later they begin to clarify their words and you begin to understand what they're saying. And it's the same thing with us, that we can't remain in the da da ma ma stage. We have to come beyond that and begin to speak the word of God as we learn that word of God. And we'll see things change in our lives that we've never seen change before. Let's take a look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And we're going to look at verse number 1. Praise the Lord. And the scripture says, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. And we get to a point sometimes that we're not growing in the things of God. And when God is speaking a word to us, because of our immaturity in that area, we can't comprehend or we can't receive the word he's speaking to us. It's just like we're still babies. It's just like we're still an infant. And that's the thing about God's word. The Bible says we're changed from glory to glory. We're to grow. We're to increase. God is a God of increase. God is a God of multiplication. God is not a God of stagnation. And neither should we be in a position that we want to remain stagnant. Our desire should be, which God gives us the desires of our heart, our desire should be to grow and mature in the things of God, so we don't have to be like that dog that goes back to our vomit, trying to do the old thing, trying to get different results. That's the sign of an insane person, a person that keeps doing the same thing and expecting different results.
is a sign of insanity. And God knows we're clothed in our right minds, praise God. We have the mind of Christ, and we think clearly because God has given us that ability to do that, and he's given us the blueprint, which is word, to conquer each and every circumstance, each and every situation that we face in our lives if we only believe. It boils down to us believing what God has to say in his word. And like that centurion man, he knew the power of Jesus. And he knew that all Jesus had to do was speak a word. Just speak the word, and my servant's going to be made whole. And that's where we want to be, where we know that when we're speaking God's language, when we're speaking the proper words, that God's will is being done on earth as it is in heaven. So when I come up against a mountain, and I don't run to my wife, and I don't run to my friend, and I don't run to this one and run to that, talking about how big the mountain is. Oh, look at this big old mountain. Man, what a mountain. No, the Bible didn't tell us to talk about it. It said talk to it. So with new confidence, you speak the word only. Says, speak to the mountain and say, be moved and be carried over yonder, and it's going to be done if we only believe. If we only believe. And that's where we got to get, where our belief is in God is so strong that when we speak that word, which is his word, when we speak that word to every circumstance, every situation, that we go on about our business. That we walk away in peace and comfort, knowing that God's word can't return to him void. It's going to accomplish the thing that he purposed it to do. Praise God. So that's what we want to be, in faith, in faith. As we continue to grow and learn of God, we also grow and learn and have a proper or deeper understanding of the power of our own words. Created in his image, after his likeness. God said, we say. God brought life, we bring life. The Bible even goes on to tell us that the words of our mouth speak life, but they also speak death. And it's so easy to fall into that trap of speaking negativity and speaking what the opinions of others are and killing a situation instead of putting life into that situation. So many people go through marital issues and marital problems, and they speak so much death because they're speaking all the negative things about the situation that they never ever try to speak life into that thing and build that relationship back up. The words of our mouth, the power of our words. So as we continue to grow and learn of God, we also grow and learn in a deeper measure the power of our very own words. Then we can take those very same words, glory to God, we can take those same words and utilize them to obtain victory in every situation that we encounter. Glory to God, hallelujah. So that sums it up concerning the power of words. I hope you understood some things during this series, that we've got some power in these mouths. And it's time to utilize that power for the glory of God and for the victory that God says we have. He says we're victorious. He says we're more than conquerors. We're overcomers. God says we're the head, not the tail. He heaps so many accolades upon us, because he knows what he's created. And when we speak his language, that's when that nothing is impossible to him who believes kicks in. When we speak the language of God, we move mountain, saints. I was just ministering to a good friend of mine today, going through some issues, him and his wife. And he said, I guess I got to just keep praying. I said, yeah, you keep praying, brother, because prayer changes things. I'm a living witness. I'm a living witness. Prayer changes things. Had it not been for people praying for me, I wouldn't be before you right now bringing this word of God to you. But somebody prayed for me. Somebody prayed for you. And I pray because that prayer has brought us to the place that we are right now, that we're ones now that are utilizing the power of our words to stand in the gap for others at this time. There's people that are hurting, people that are struggling, people that are having a hard time coming to grips with what's going on in the world today. But there's a peace. See, I'm going to speak the word about this thing now. There's a peace that surpasses all understanding that'll guard our hearts and guard our minds in Christ Jesus. So why can't we speak about that peace right now? Let's not get caught up in the tsunami of all the things that are going on right now. But let's get caught up in the peace that surpasses our understanding. And you know you got that peace when it surpasses your understanding. You don't even know why you're so calm. You don't even know why you're so peaceful. I'll tell you why. Because you spoke the word, and the word healed the situation. Speak the word over your life. Speak the word over your children. Speak the word over your finances. Speak the word over your relationship. Speak it over that job you're on. Speak the word and watch the results that have come forth because of the power of the words in your mouth. I thank God for you. Thank God that you tuned in. Thank God that you were so attentive to the sessions. If you missed any of these sessions, they're on our YouTube channel. You can go back and catch up and bring everything into the proper perspective, because it's kind of hard to come in at the end of the movie and figure out what happened if you haven't built through the whole movie. So you can go back and look at them again, or you can look at them all in succession, one right after the other, and get the fullness of this thing. But whatever you do, hold fast to your profession of faith, because that's what's going to keep us in this day and in this hour. As is my custom, I want to always never end the broadcast without putting an invitation out there, because you never know who's watching. You never know who God has led to look at these broadcasts. So somebody may have been looking at this broadcast today and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. You know about him. You heard about him. You may have even gone to church from time to time. You may even hang out with Christian people. You may not be a person that drinks or cuss or do anything like that, but you don't have a relationship with him. You've never accepted him as your Lord and Savior. In other words, you've never publicly confessed with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord of my life. Well, today is your opportunity. I want to give you that chance right now as you're listening to me, because we're going to go through a prayer together and salvation is going to come into your household. Just believe. The Bible says that no man comes to the Father except through Jesus Christ, which is why it's so vitally important. Yeah, you can love God. You can love God. You may be a lover of God, love God all your life. But until you get that relationship with his son, Jesus, then there'll be no time that you'll be spending with God, because no man comes to God except through Jesus Christ. So today, we want to make sure that you have a relationship with Jesus. And I'm going to lead you in a simple prayer. It comes from Romans chapter 10, verse 9, where it says that if we would confess with our mouths, the power in that mouth, see, if we would confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and would believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, we could be saved. And so it states that, Romans 10 and 9, it means what it says. So it's really quite simple. If you just repeat with me right where you are, if you just repeat these words with me, I'm going to lead you in this prayer. Lord Jesus, here I am before you now, realizing and recognizing that I am a sinner. Because I am a sinner, I need a Savior. And that Savior is you. I'm going to do just what your word told me to do, because I know your word won't return to you void. I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus I believe in my heart that God has raised you from the dead. And you said, if I did those things, I could be saved. Well, guess what? If you prayed that prayer with me, you are saved. See, it wasn't difficult at all, was it? Sometimes we wait so long. Sometimes we come with so many excuses. Why I can't come to Jesus? Because I don't want to play with him. I want to come to him 100. All these things people say. But if we could have gotten ourselves together, we would have done it a long time ago. The fact that we couldn't get ourselves together is why we need a Savior, and his name is Jesus. And because you just accepted him, I want to welcome you to the family. Oh, what a wonderful life you have in front of you, because now Jesus is Lord. And every promise in that Bible now belongs to you, because you are an heir according to those promises. But as in new things, there comes new ways of doing things. Old things, the Bible says, have to pass away. Behold, all things become new. So now you have a new journey before you, a new life to live, a brand new beginning. And my job as a pastor is to assist you in your new walk with Jesus Christ. So I'm giving you my phone number. It's area code 810-814-3260. If you desire to give me a call, we can talk about your new walk with Jesus. I can instruct you in some things and get you and keep you on the right path with your new salvation. Amen. Or if you like to deal with emails, you can just send me an email to Pastor Kimmy Montgomery at gmail.com. And as I receive that email with your questions and concerns, to the best of my ability, I'll respond back and hopefully have the proper answer to keep you on the right track. Amen. Because when I answer your questions, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to speak the word of holy. Praise God. So praise God. Thank you once again for tuning in. We have just concluded our final session on the power of words. We'll be starting on a whole new series upcoming next Thursday. In the meantime, we are located at 3702 North Franklin Avenue in Flint, Michigan. Still working out the details on when we shall return back to our facility. But in the meantime, I want you to keep tuning in. I'm going to be here on Thursdays. I'm going to be here on Sundays. I'm going to still be delivering the word of God. Praise the Lord. And I want you to be a part of what God is doing in this time and in this hour. So once again, thank you so much for tuning in, and I will be back with you guys on Sunday morning. God bless.